And now, please welcome to the stage our keynote speaker, who's going to tell you how to get shit done. Please have a warm welcome to Sven.
All right. Hey, welcome to HeapCon and to my keynote. So I'm Sven. I work for a company called Atlassian. I'm a DevOps advocate. And you might think, why is this person from Atlassian on stage here at HeapCon talking about developer joy? I mean, you think like this is obvious, right? We have the best jobs in the world. We just like create things, right? We can just like create something with just like a few lines of code that our customers can use and make our customers happy. So why in the hell are we talking about this developer joy? How do we enjoy our work? So said that is there's happening something in the last 10 years. Software development has actually changed. The way we write code, the way we develop, the way what our craft is has actually changed in the last 10 years. So looking back, right, what has changed? And I'm so long in this industry, so I remember the other times too. So first thing is just like the cloud came, right? So we had to learn new things, how to develop stuff for the cloud. New toolings, new concepts, all those things, right? So this has changed, right? And all of a sudden, we're running things in little small containers, and we have to put our things in containers, and we have to learn how to deal with that, and how to spin up containers, how to tear them down, all the things, how to deploy things in containers. And then also, we just like build now everything in small little microservices, so we have to take care about the APIs that we create. And what is if the microservice is not reachable on the other end? We have to take care about that too. And what is if the API changes? This is super new. Otherwise, in the monolith, it's just that you can just like call it, you can just like do it immediately. And then also security and governance, right? This is a problem that we didn't have really before. But now that everything is in the cloud, we have to make things secure so no one can actually get into our software. And yeah, you heard that, Werner Vogel from AWS, he said it just like, I think, 15 years ago, you build it, you run it. So now, all of a sudden, we are not just responsible for just like building the software, we are also responsible what happens if the service is down. We have to just like be on call and we run it ourselves. We have to just like configure the infrastructure through code and all those things just like has been put on top of normal software development, what we have done 10 years ago. And obviously, right, this introduces a lot of cognitive load on software developers. We have to do more things. We have to keep more things in our mind, right? So, but now our CTOs, tech leaders, managers are coming in and saying, you know what? You're not productive anymore. So how do we get you back to productivity, right? You need to be more productive. We have so many developers. I'm talking to a lot of these managers. They say, yeah, Sven, tell us, how can we get our developers more productive? All right. For that, I want to just like take you on a little journey, if you're fine with that. I've traveled back in time. Are you okay with that? Yeah? All right. So we travel back 125 years, and I guarantee you, I'll bring you back, okay? So we're not stuck in the past, hopefully. So so let's count to three, and then we travel back in time. Can you help me? One, two, three. All right, where we are. Oh, we are in the Bethlehem Steel Factory, right? And the Bethlehem Steel Factory at that time had some productivity issues. They had some problems with their productivity. At that time, there was no McKinsey or Boston Consulting Group to call, right, to get in a bunch of consultants and help with productivity issues, right, change everything, transformation, all the things. No, didn't exist at that time. But there was one person who they actually hired, and his name was Frederick Winslow Taylor. Anyone heard of Frederick Winslow Taylor here? One, two, a few people. All right, good. So what Frederick Winslow Taylor did was he came in and just like put out his stopwatch. And just like measured, right? Measured how fast things were flowing, right? And then he arranged maybe something. So he just like shortened the time, how people just like produce the steel in the factory. the first thing that he did was actually he looked at shuffles, right? And it was just like watching how people were shuffling coal. And there was a lot of coal falling left and right from the shuffle. So he actually introduced custom-made shuffles who can better shuffle coal. You can better shuffle coal without shuffles. And it helped to increase productivity of the factory workers. Pretty simple thing, just like good tooling helps with productivity. And then he was watching actually the workers. So he was watching them just like how they were carrying things, right? So obviously the workers could carry more in the morning than in the evening. They got exhausted. So what he introduced was actually, well, a few breaks in between. So overall, they could just like carry more throughout the day. So he just like changed a bunch of other things. It's like taking up a stopwatch, optimizing the hell out of the factory, and he increased productivity of the factory workers by 400%. Whoa, right? But hey, everything comes with a flip side, right? So also, he just like introduced new roles. The role of the worker was new. The worker was just like doing repetitive tasks. They were not supposed to think. But he also introduced the managers, right? And the managers were the ones that just like optimized the productivity of the factory workers. So they would do the thinking. All right, this is 125 years ago, right? So what has that to do with developer productivity today? Well, I think we're falling back into the Taylorism times often, right? Because we actually learned that it's working, right? It is working. It's improving productivity. Taylor has proven it. Factories have proven it to optimize everything the hell out of it, just like helps, right? So how do we actually measure, and let's travel back into the year 2023, just like how do we improve developer productivity or how do we measure it, right? The first job that I had, actually, my boss asked me to count the lines of code we added. Obviously, we all know this is not a good measure for just like showing how productive we are. Like I can add a bunch of lines of code, right? And just like look like I'm super productive without being really productive and producing anything. So we just like said, okay, let's count the issues that we move into done. But this is also not a good productivity measurement because actually I can move a lot of issues to done. There are smaller and larger issues, and that doesn't really say when I just like count the number of issues. Story points, yeah, you name it, right? Yeah, we have now story points, great. We're doing Scrum, we have story points, all good. Or even just like even better, we have T-shirt sizes now, just like small, medium, large, right, stories. But you know what? This is just an estimate. So you just like, before you're actually doing the task, you're estimating how big this task is, but this is not just like good measurements for productivity at all, because it can be, you can't just like say, oh, that's an easy one, and then just like it turns out you just like have to spend weeks on that. So also not a good measurement for productivity. And now we're just like looking at cycle time and deployment frequency, you might have Dora metrics, all of these things. So let's assume we have the perfect measurement of productivity, even though that doesn't exist, right? What's happening then? Our manager come in and say, we measure it, and then we want to improve it, right? We want 10% more story points or 20% faster pull request reviews. Whew. Thank you very much, Frederick Winslow Taylor, right? Just like push the hell out of it and introduce more cognitive load to developers, right? Now, there's another movement right now. It's called we're improving the developer experience. And don't get me wrong, I think this is just like a great term, right? We want to improve the developer experience to improve the productivity. I think this is it's a good term. But there are already consultant companies that come up with strange frameworks that this is actually improving the developer experience somehow. Or even other consultancy groups like the McKinsey group that want to measure productivity by just like measuring story points on an individual level and on a team level, on a system level, and all the things, right? So all not really measuring productivity or like developer experience in that term. And that's why we at Atlassian, we just like said, okay, let's go back to what we really want. And we want to go back to developer joy, right? Because we believe actually, if developers enjoy what they do, they're happy and they are also productive. And this is the goal that we want to reach. So Let's talk a little bit about developer joy. When is it that we enjoy our job? What does it need that we enjoy our job? Of course, we need a good team, but on the work side, we need work on great quality code. Like, we enjoy working on great quality code. If I can just like look at it, it makes sense, I can read it very fast, I can just like change it very fast, it's good quality code, it doesn't break, great, right? The next thing is just like progress. I want to just like move my task fast through the pipelines, it's just like have an idea on Monday, and deploy it to our customers on Wednesday, right? We want to just like have fast progress that we deliver value fast to our customers, and not just like deliver it fast to our customers, but deliver the right things to our customers. We want to create value. So when our customer come back and say, oh, we love what you just like released, it's just like the best thing ever. It's helping us to be just like better at our work. Just like, guess what? If these three things come together, just like great quality code, I can move things fast, and I create stuff that my customers love, I enjoy what I'm doing. On the other side, I'm also productive, right? So this is really what we want to achieve. So I brought to you a few stories here from Atlassian, what developers came in and changed the way they worked and improved their developer joy. So the first thing is just like the quality, right? And we talk about technical debt a lot, right? And we did some research on this, right? So 42% of all developer time is actually used, and this is not just like internally at Atlassian, we just like made a broader developer survey, is used for dealing with technical debt. That's a lot, right? But just like 10% of the development teams are actually manage their technical debt actively. Well, this is just like not good, right? It's just like a downspin, so we get more technical debt, which introduced more technical debt then. But why does it happen? Why does technical debt actually happen, and how can we deal with it? So let's assume I've written this nice, cool class here. It's just like stupid, but just like don't look at it. But just like you assume, like I have just like small little great class, right? And then I go on vacation. And my coworkers are actually just like changing stuff on my class, and I come back and open that class and just like, I want to see that. I'm super proud of it. And then I see, oh, my coworkers have added actually quite some lines. Wow, they messed it up. Well, guess what? Sometimes it starts out nicely, but then sometimes it ends up in a mess. And this is happening. And it's not the fault of my coworkers. I don't want to blame them for that, because they just like thought, okay, I need to just like, I just like put it in here, it fits in here, and just like then I fix it maybe on Monday morning, and then Monday morning something else happened, some Slack messages, some emails came in, some alerts, so we just like jump on that, and we totally forgot about that we wanted to fix that and make that look good, right? But the question is also just like, who tells us what good looks like, right? Have you defined that? Do you know what good looks like? So the Bitbucket team actually had that problem. So they're working with Python code, and they just like had that problem that they didn't really agree on what good looks like. So they came up with coding guidelines, and I hope you all have coding guidelines, right? So it just don't makes the code look nicer, and you agree on what good looks like. It also makes the code at the end more readable, because everyone just like following the guidelines. I know there are tools out there that can just like check that automatically, right? But not everything yet. I don't know how AI is changing the game on this, but not actually everything yet. So like the single responsibility principle, right? How do you check that? Well, what we do is we're doing a lot of code reviews, and you're doing code reviews too, right? Yeah, you're doing, right? You're doing code reviews, okay, agree. Good, great. So we're doing it massively at Atlassian, but there's a problem with code reviews, if you look at that. So let's assume I have added this bunch of code here, the while loop, and then put it in a pull request. First reviewer comes in and says, what the fuck, Sven? I say, oh, God. All right, well, I can just like hold myself back and say, okay, great. I said, what do you mean, right? And the person said, oh, this code looks ugly. I say, whew, I'm already done with code reviews. I don't want to do it again. I don't want to do it anymore, right? I stop it here. I don't want to just like have this feedback for my code, right? But hey, I just like, I'm a polite person. So I said, okay, explain me more, right? And then the person says, it would be nicer if you'd use a for loop, and said, what does nicer mean, right? The while loop works, but what do we mean by nicer, right? So one advice, if you're doing these kinds of comments on code reviews, here's one advice. Don't be a jerk, right? Right? So don't be a jerk. So actually, who has been bullied by a jerk here recently, let's say in the last 2 weeks? No, just like don't raise your hands, please. I know your coworkers are in the room, so we're in a safe place here. All right. But these people are actually the reason why people don't like code reviews, right? Just like this feeling that you have, just like someone criticizes your code, and it's like, no, be polite, right? So the Jira team wanted to do something about that. So they actually looked at it from a just like fresh perspective. And they said just like, okay, the reviewer is in that protected bubble, right? You can just like shoot out of your protected bubble. But as an author, we need to protect that author a little bit more, right? Because the author is just like opening their work up, right? They're opening up and they get feedback for their work. So they came up with some rules, right? Like assume competence. Everyone got hired for a reason, right? They did a lot of interviews, code sessions, right? Tech tests, all the things, right? Assume that the developer is competent to do the job. Second thing is be constructive in your feedback, right? This code looks ugly is not constructive, right? Just like be constructive, be on point, right? And then also explain your reasoning. A for loop would be nicer. What's the reason? Tell me. I want to learn too. So they wrote all this down in some sessions that they did, and they came up with the pull request submission and review etiquette and wrote that down, and everyone should follow that. And once in a while, people just like violating that. So they can then go in and just like add a comment, say, hey, just like look at our etiquette. We agreed on that. Do you also agree? Please don't do these nasty comments. All right. So better reviews means no bullying, right? We don't accept that. And also more developer joy, right? You enjoy more what you do, right? You enjoy if you have just like constructive feedback from your coworkers. All right. So let's say we have just like great code, we check it in, we merge it, boom, right? Then the Confluence team actually had the following problem. So the test is running, right? And when we were just like doing automatic testing, so the tests are running, and sometimes it happens that the test turns red. Well, it's okay, right? That's why we have tests. We just like take a look at it, take a look at the code, at the changes, and just like investigate why is this test red, right? Like, why does it fail? Why does the test fail? I have no idea. So spending half an hour, maybe 45 minutes on it, and I can't find it. I don't know what to do. What's next? What should I do next, right? What I do is just like, okay, let's rerun the test and see what it's doing. And then you just like rerun the test and boom, test is green. Great, we can go on, right? Okay, good. No. We just like discovered a flaky test here. So it's time for a commercial. So just like, excuse me, I'm back in a few minutes.
Is seeing red build after red build getting old? Is rerunning your failed jobs getting you down? Is waiting on those failed jobs to finish making you crazy? Deterministic Reliability is here to help. With our handy-dandy flaky test monitoring system, we will, eventually, automatically bypass those flaky tests. For 4 easy payments of free, you too can save time, ship quality code faster, be more productive, feel so much better when you go to work every day. You will be happier. Your team will be happier. You'll stop dying inside. You'll stop banging your head against your desk. You'll stop replacing computers that are in a rage against the wall. Sorry. It's just a little close to home. Call 1-800-ATLASSIAN today to get your free flake monitoring system.
All right. So there is no flaky test detector that we put out there. So don't go there. We just like build it internally. So the Confluence team built that internally. They call it flake off. And here's what it's doing. Just like you create a pull request, it kicks off. You kick off the build and test. It fails, right? Flaky test detector says, "Let me take over. I rerun the test for 4 to 10 times and discover the test passes. Okay, I've reached a flaky test here. I saw a flaky test. So What should I do, right? The next thing is just like we mark this test as skip test, add a comment to the pull request, right, that someone has to take a look at that and fix it or delete it or whatever, right? And then also, yeah, there's a Slack message in the team room saying, just look at that. There's a flaky test. Someone needs to just like go on that immediately, right? And it helps the team to have less debug frustration because you don't go into the debug phase. It's just like the flaky test detector takes over. And guess what? It has saved a lot of engineering hours, actually, at Atlassian, just this flaky test detector. And more developer joy at the end because you don't just like debug and have the frustration that discovered a flaky test. All right, so let's talk about flow and progress, right? So I love being in the flow, right? I love to just like being in the flow when I code. But coding is not just everything in software development, right? There's also the build and test phase and the deploy phase. And we need to just like optimize the flow also here. We can go from hours to minutes and build and test by parallelizing things or whatever, having better toolings. And then also deploy phase, maybe we just like deploy a small microservice instead of the whole like package, right? But there's one thing that takes a lot of time, and that's the review phase, right? It can take days. Actually, here also the Confluence teams, because we're measuring a lot of things, that was measuring it. And it took them 3 days on average to just like from opening a pull request to merge it back. That means 3 days on working on something else, concentrating, and then coming back to, oh, what I have done 3 days ago. That's probably not good. And also our customers are waiting for these features that are in the pull request to just like be deployed. So as I said, the one team in Confluence here, they actually have these open pull requests, and then they have a team lead called Punit Arora. So Punit actually, he just said, okay, we need to be faster in reviewing our pull requests. So what he did is actually every morning he wrote an email to everyone or a Slack message saying, hey, look at your open pull request. I see you are on an open pull request. Please review that pull request, right? In the morning, before you actually go into the coding phase and just like be in the flow, right? So that helps actually. But after a while, the team said, okay, great, Punit, we love it. Just like we forgot about the pull request yesterday, and so good reminder here, good reminder that we should do the pull request. And now we're also making our pull requests a little bit smaller so we can just like review them faster. So it's a more habit of doing this reviews. But it's not your job to ping us. So they replaced Punit with a bot called the Punit bot that is now pinging actually everyone in the morning, just like saying, hey, I know you might miss have the notification. So they went down from 3 days to 1.2 days. Still room for improvement. We still want to get better at that, but it's actually a good progress here, which means actually less wait time for the developer. Of course, they were not waiting, but they were working on something else. Less wait time and more developer joy, right? As I said, I'm obsessed with flow. And actually with flow at work, right? How works flows through our pipelines. So let's take a look at traffic and flow, right? So I want to see just like this is a junction, totally chaos, right? And traffic flow is 191 vehicles per minute, right? So if we work, just like if we translate that to work, it is actually okay. Let's do whatever we want and then just like figure out. So this is how work flows. But we know. Maybe it works in a 5-people team, just like everyone just like figures out where to go. But it doesn't work in a 100-people company, right? So what we do is actually we add some processes. So just like handing over stuff and things like that. So if we add heavy processes to this in traffic, which means just like we add some traffic lights, right? So one team can just like go full speed, the other team needs to stop, and then they can go full speed. So this is just like the simulation that we have. And in this simulation, actually, we have a traffic flow of 235 cars per minute, right? Okay, we improved the flow, right? Great, right? Going from chaos to a little bit more processes seems to just like work, improve the flow. But now we don't want to just like wait, right? We just like had that. We just like want to be agile, right? So we want to slot in work whenever there's a fit, right? So this sounds more like a roundabout, right? And you see there's also a fast lane where cars can go fast into the roundabout, right? So every time the design team has a slot, we slot it in, the design team can work on it and hand it over back to the developers, right? And also here, traffic flow increases, but so 360 cars per minute. Great. Okay, agile is the way to go, right? Good. But there's one more thing, right? And it's called the stack interchange. And you can see just like no car is stopping at all, right? At the roundabout, you could see cars stopping. But here, it's just like merging automatically, right? How do we get that flow into our work that we don't have to stop, we don't have to wait, we don't have to call? How do we get that into our work, right? Just like traffic flow 1099, that's what we want to reach, right? The answer is autonomous teams, right? So just like building autonomous teams that own a task from end to end. Right, being autonomous. What does that mean, right? We need to align those teams, of course, to work together, but we need a designer on the team, we need QA on the team, we need IT operations on the team, right? All those roles, product managers, all those roles need to be on the team to not being stopped by other teams, to not have dependencies to other teams. Now, the thing is, the Trello team had a problem, right, with that. Because if you look at QA, for example, right, getting QA on a team just like there's no really full job for a QA person on just like one development team, right? So they have to be split. And also the ratio that we have is just like 1 to 30 from QA to developers, right? That doesn't really work if we just like put a QA person in every team to just like let them build things autonomously. But we looked at it and we wanted to just like have more autonomy for the development teams, for the product teams, for the stream-aligned teams. So thing is, QA was doing the exploratory testing, so just like testing after test plan, and then devs were doing the automated testing. So we split that up that all developers are doing actually both things, right? They're doing now the automated testing and the exploratory testing, and QA is just there for assistance. We call it quality assistance, not quality assurance. So what they came up with is QA kickoffs. So in a QA kickoff, before you actually develop a feature or a user story, the quality assistance engineer comes to the developer and they talk about just like how would you test that feature once it is done, right? Once you implemented it. So they build a test plan for that. They just like look at the test plan and build it for that. And then they say, okay, off you go. It's now your responsibility. You take over. It's your responsibility to build high quality code, right? It's good for team autonomy too. So QA kickoff, and then the developers doing the implementation, the testing themselves, and deploy it. There's one more phase called the demo phase, and I will come to that later a bit. That's just like a little bit of a safety net for the QA teams to look at what the developers has built. But also, they're doing blitz testing. So blitz testing is the whole team is responsible for the quality. So once a developer has done a feature, and that's a very critical feature, the whole team tests the hell out of it, right? So also, they're doing blitz testing. And then also, the QA people are more building the test environments, test databases, test data, all those things. This is what the QA is now responsible for, and the developers don't have to deal with that. Less cognitive load for the developers, right? And more developer joy. So the last example that I want to talk about is just like creating value. And if you look at that, we need to work together with the product managers, right? And the developers. We speak different language. Sometimes we think we're living on a different planet, but we have to connect those planets somehow. So, true story here. Once I was just like dealing with a product manager, and the user story that I got from the product manager was this one here. As a user, I want to export the data so I can have it in an Excel file. So there was just like user data that they wanted to export and they can have it in an Excel file. So I built that. I gave it to them. They looked at it and said, ah, we just like want a specific data from that. So I was just like, okay, yeah, so, okay, as a user, I want to export the important data, some specific data from the users, so I can have it in an Excel file. Okay, so I built that, right? I just like implemented it, good, was easy peasy, gave it to the product manager. The product manager said, we didn't know that Excel and CSV files are two different things, so we actually need a CSV file. So I was just like, oh, Okay, next user story. As a user, I want to export the important data so I can have it in CSV file. Great. Okay, now I'm good, right? So I say, okay, that's perfect, right? So we can take the CSV file and just like import it into our CRM system. I said, what? You want to import it in a CRM system, right? There are APIs, so I could just like shuffle the data over through the API. That would be like much, much more easier. So I was actually super frustrated, so I built that with the API. It is because we didn't talk about it, right? I just like got the user story and just like implemented it, right? And I don't want to blame product people for it. This is like both sides need to talk to each other. Product is doing a lot of research, measurements, interviews, experiments, prototypes, all those things. This is what product cares about. And then they squeeze everything into small little user stories, right? Throw it over the wall, and we just like have to implement it without us talking to the product people and understanding the real why. There was a long discussion, and the Jira team just like wanted to fix that thing, right? They wanted to just like bring product and developers closer together so they work together on the why, on the feature that they really deliver value to the customer. So when you look at that, the software people were saying, or the developers were saying, just like, we are responsible for the make phase, right? We are creating things. And product people are responsible for the wonder phase, what we call wonder phase, the problem phase. But it's not just that. We also added some more phases, just like more the explore phase. Once we identify the problem, we have to explore the solutions. And then also the measure phase, right? Does the thing that we've built actually solve the problem? Right? So all these phases, we need to be involved as developers into all those phases. Now, we can't, right? We have already so much cognitive load, and we're just like also taking over the operations, all those things, right? Because we're not involved in all phases with the same energy and with the same amount of time. So we're probably most involved in the create phase, a little bit in the measure phase, and a little bit in the problem phase. But the product people are more involved into other phases, right? So we defined different stages here so we can involve everyone. So we're starting with project kickoffs. Once the problem was identified by the product people, we did project kickoffs where we involved everyone, the designers, the IT operations people, the QA people, everyone that was just like building the product was involved in the project kickoff. We could ask questions, or we were asking questions in the kickoff. Then by building prototypes, it's not just like that we just like take the Figma prototypes and just like implement them. We also need to just like work on prototypes. We are involved in that and seeing, okay, is that technically feasible? Can we build that with the technology that we have, or just like we have to look at something else? Then we're doing demos, right? During our development phase, so we can involve product people and say, hey, this is what we built. And I will talk about demos in a sec a little bit more. And then also we're doing something called goal sickness measures, where we just like look at the measurements together as a team and say, okay, does it have the right impact that we actually wanted in the wonder phase? Does it really work like this? So as I said, I want to talk a bit about the demo phase, right? Because this is what developers are owning. So demos, we're inviting people to regular demos. They are not in person anymore. We're doing them mostly over Zoom meetings where we present something. These demos are recorded, so everyone in the company can look at that. And this is super important, right? It's open. Everyone can join. Everyone can join. These are open demos. Everyone can just like join the Zoom meeting or watch the recording later. Super important that we have the product managers there, the QA people there, right? And then it is outcome oriented. We are showing customer value. We're not talking about implementation details in the demos. We're showing real customer value that we create. Then it's an open space. So we can discuss things, we challenge the solution, and sometimes the product manager come and say, oh, let me take that back to the customer. That doesn't feel right. So just like get feedback from the customer early in the process so we can change things before we deploy it actually. And then also we celebrate the wins because we're just like together. We are together creating a feature. It's not just the developers. It's not the QA people. It's not the product people. We're all creating that feature, and we should celebrate together once we just like hit a milestone. So this is how we run demo sessions, and it helps us to just like stop the rework frustration when we just like find out at the end that there wasn't the thing that we should build, and introduced more developer joy. Now, these are just like stories from Atlassians, and you might say, okay, great, but how do you measure now productivity, right? What would Frederick Winslow Taylor say to this, right? It seems very fluffy what you're doing, right? Yeah. And it was not Frederick Winslow Taylor, but it was Peter Drucker that said, if you can't measure it, you can't improve it, right? So where should you start measuring how good your developer experience is, how your performance is, right? You might have heard of the DORA metrics. So if you don't know where to start, take a look at the DORA metrics. It's proven that those metrics can improve your developer experience and your developer productivity. But don't just like look at that. Take those metrics and just like think about what is really important for the team. What do you want for your team, right? Where do you have problems in your team? Just is it the deployment frequency? If it's not, then it's fine. Just like leave it out, right? So just like look at what is really important for your team and take that as a measurement. What's the problem in your team, right? So we are actually using Compass, our own tool, a developer experience platform that just went GA, I think, 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago. And you can see just like we have the scorecards in there, so we can see just like all those measurements. And we add also baselines to it, right? So we can just like see if the DevOps health goes down. We can see that. Now, this is a little bit like governance on demand, right? And there's a little problem with that, right? Maybe you just like see, okay, it's just 51% in that scorecard, and then you have just like different measurements, and it's called this the wallboard problem. So back in the days, we all had wallboards in the office where we just like showed the build state of certain or test state of certain tests that we were running, and sometimes all the tests were red, right? And no one were caring about it anymore. So just like, yeah, it's red. We just like, we know. But it's still working, right? It's still working. So this is also the problem if you just like have those metrics and they all turn red, right? So what we do is actually we're doing a weekly ritual called checkups. And in this checkups, we're looking at those metrics as a team and say, okay, deployment frequency went down. It's not bad, right? Because we know actually that we're working on very complicated part of the code. So well, we'll go up again eventually. Or you just like see, oh, we didn't realize that. We need to do some things about it. So actually, we build checkups. You can do that just like on a template or for your team, right? Or we just like build it directly into Compass so you have a side-by-side view of your metrics and what you want to do with it, right? So measurements is great, right? GitHub actually did an experiment here. So it's called the Good Day Project. So they asked the developers, how productive have you been today? And obviously, just like there were productive days, and some days that you feel productive, and some days that you really don't feel very productive, right? And then they were overlaying that data with activities per day. So just like how many activities we're doing and all those measurements. And guess what? There was no correlation between those data. People were just like feeling super, super productive, but the data was showing no, not productive at all. Or the other way around, right? So can we really measure productivity is the question, right? And we tend to fall back then into the Taylorism times where we just like think, okay, we have to optimize the hell out of that, right? We need to squeeze the review phase from 3 days to 1 day and the deploy phase. But this is coming from a production industry. It has nothing to do with creative jobs, right? But we are building not the same car over and over again, right? We're building new software every day. We just like, we build software that hasn't been, or we write software that hasn't been written before. It's all new, right? So this is not, we shouldn't treat actually software development like a production line. We shouldn't do that, right? Instead, we should just like measure what's important and don't make important what you can measure. And I see a lot of companies just like saying, oh, we apply the DORA metrics and now we're just like good, everything is good. But still, we're not productive, right? So how do you do that? It's very simple. It's very simple how you can improve your developer experience, right? Ask your developers. Ask how they feel, what they should fix. They actually know what the problem is in their software development. So we were doing that. We are doing that regularly. We have developed a survey called the Developer Joy Survey, and we're asking, like, are you satisfied with your speed to ship quality code? Are you satisfied with your waiting time, right? Are you satisfied with your execution independence, with your access to tools, processes, and practices, or with your effort of managing external standards like governments and security? Are you satisfied with managing your pipeline, your infrastructure, and your code? Or do we have a problem there? What is about ramp-up time if you just like get new developers in? Does it take too long? to do that. And what's your developer satisfaction overall, right? And we're not just like asking these questions and asking like, are you satisfied with that? We also know that teams are different and they have different problems. So we're also asking like, how important is that for your team actually? So time is over and I'm almost done. So we take those measurements and calculate an opportunity score out of that, right? And put it on a nice picture. So, and have a traffic light system attached to it. So everything that's in the green phase is just like, seems to be okay, right? Then the yellow ones are turning more into that direction that it is seemed to be important and people are not satisfied with it. And the red things, we need to do something about those things. We need to go there in a team as a team and fix those things, right? So I actually built that developer joy survey in a type form. If you want to try it out, you can scan the QR code and just like see how your developer satisfaction is overall. And I recommend also to doing that with your team to just like take a look at your developer joy overall, right? So next step is just like, if you know you have a problem here, right, and wait time or whatever, you need to try and fix things, right? You need to do and fix some stuff here, right? As you saw, just like I had a couple of examples from Atlassian teams that were just like looking at that and fixing things like the Punit bot, they shortened the code review time. And then also important is not just to try to fix things in a team, because other teams may have the same problem. Surprise, surprise. So you also should just like spread the learnings, right? Get the message out there and spread the learnings. So as an example here, we write a lot of blog posts in our internal Confluence instance. As an example here, it's the Punit bot, right? So the Punit people, the team wrote up a blog post about just like, what is the Punit bot all about? How does it work? And how can you use it? And now there are probably 20 teams or 22 teams, I checked that last time, to just like use the Punit bot and use it to just like inform the developers that there's an open pull request. So that helps. All right, sum this up here. Take your measurements. It's not bad. It's showing you signals, right? Talk about those, right? And take your service results. As I said, just like take both things, talk about those, and give that to your autonomous teams, right? And give them also time. At Atlassian, we get 10% of our time to work on developer productivity issues. Give them time to actually fix things, right? And not just like fix things in developer quality, progress, and creating value for the customers. And I always wanted to do a Venn diagram here in the talk, and it's that. Right in the middle there, if you create great code, if your code quality is great, if you're moving things fast, and if your customers love what you do, right, I'd super enjoy what I'm doing if this happens, right? And right in the middle there, this is really where developer joy actually happens. But also, as I said, it's called developer joy because we just like actually choose this job for a reason, because we want to create things, right? And don't forget the fun we have by creating stuff for our customers and getting the feedback back and just like working on code, right? Don't forget to have fun. And thank you very much. Enjoy HeapCon. Have a great day, and see you around. Thanks.